there at the top of it, and sure enough, it went flu. And in July 1783, they tested for the first time a balloon that would carry someone, but it didn't carry a person. They thought it David John is known to most as DJ or Gibbo. He was born in Southport and started his career in the Royal Navy in 1996, where he trained to fly the Sea King in the support helicopter role. DJ has now regained his airspeed and achieves 1,300 feet at the top of a half horizontal 8. Operationally, DJ has flown the Sea King in a variety of areas, including Sierra Leone and the Persian Gulf. He also spent 3 years flying search and rescue missions off the Cornish coast. DJ is now serving in the Royal Air Force, and when not displaying, he is responsible for training qualified military pilots to become instructors on the Grob Shooter. During his varied career, DJ has amassed over 6,000 flying hours on 50 different aircraft types. Today, the Shooter is flown by the Royal Air Force's largest flying school, No. 6 Flying Training School. The Shooter is used to train junior RAF pilots, university air squadron students and air cadets, being flown on air experience flights around the UK. Displaying the Shooter requires the pilot to be meticulous with his energy management. DJ now uses a wing over to...
Yes, because of course going into battle in a VIC formation like this, it's only the leader who's scouring the skies for the enemy, because the wingmen are just making sure they've got their eyes fixed on the leader to stay in formation. So not as efficient as the finger four method pioneered by the Luftwaffe.
It takes quite a lot to do this. It looks so easy up there, so gentle, but this afternoon, even though we don't have a lot of heat, we're getting thermals. What breeze there is on the ground is pretty much zero, but as you climb, that wind becomes a little bit stronger, so you've got to contend with that. Fortunately, all of the aircraft have the same horsepower engine, so it's not trying to do a formation with dissimilar aircraft. What a way to spend a a wonderful UK summer, just cruising around on a Sunday in one of those.
And at a location like this as well.
Magnificent. Now, what we need you to do, when they come in to do their flower bombing and their balloon bursting, we need you to shout, wave your arms in the air for your favourite aeroplane. We're going to be keeping count. Now, these guys are going to be here for a while, so over a few other displays with higher performance aircraft. Basically, a tail chase.
And the following aircraft are behind, but also slightly below the leading aircraft. That's to keep them out of the prop wash of the aircraft in front.
Quite a lot of concentration required for this. I said it's nice and gentle here today, but it's still a little bit bumpy up there. So the eyes will be out on stalks, just making sure that everything is perfect, because they want to put on a perfect formation for you guys. If you want to build one of these, you can actually do it. The plans for the manufacture of the turbine are held by the UK Light Aircraft Association. So if you join the association, you can purchase the plans from them, and you can set up in your lounge room if you're living by yourself, the garage if you have a better half,
and if you're not living by yourself and you set up
down, look how big that aeroplane is. He's coming through now down the other side.
Oh, and he's balked, he's missed. So, discretion being the better part of valour in that case. So I'm afraid those of you who are
210 kilometres an hour.
Oh, and he's pulled up once again. A bomb accurately on the house, and if they get a direct hit, there will be an explosion.
Oh! Missed by that much.
Yes. Oh.
Just undershot a little bit.
The next one needs to be right in the middle, and that will be perfect.
No. Overshot again.
Well, hopefully that pass has got their eye in, and let's see who can be more accurate on this final bombing run.
There'll be enough flour out there to make 400 scones. Or scones.
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 For the yellow aircraft. Yep. New. No prize there.
Nope.
All yellow balloons stand out against that cloudy background. We've got three up there now, so what's the red going to do? Got it! Brilliant!
And give them a cheer, because it's open cockpit, they can hear us.
They can hear you, and wave back at them, because they can see you all as well. This is not a tornado. Another big round of applause, ladies and gentlemen. See that? Just judging it, there's a little bit of a rise there right on the end of the threshold. Just clearing that. We can see the lumps and bumps from here because we're looking across the field, but they can't. It just looks green to them.
Very. Thank you, Richard.
Beautifully held off there. And the second or third landing was quite good. Empire initially came out and was hoped to actually go against the German fighters, the jet fighters during the Second World War, produced initially as a single-seater. That meeting of the Germans was not to take place because it was actually the Gloucester Meteor that became the very first jet aircraft involved in the RAF. There are over 15 single and two-seat versions, including the Sea Vampire that were produced. And it was, as we know, these aircraft were highly popular. The British designs of jet engines and airframes actually led the world straight after World War II. And these were exported to many countries. In fact, 31 different air forces. Are actually manufactured in here in the UK, in Australia, India, France, Italy, and Switzerland. It's permanent. RAF had a maximum of 19 squadrons equipped with the Vampire during its operational service. A beautiful aircraft. Why the twin boom? Basically because of the inefficiency of those first generation jet engines. The longer the jet pipe, the more inefficient the engine became. So that's what they used. Twin tail, short jet pipe. It was initially developed into an interim two-seat night fighter. And the armament that could be fitted was either two or four 20mm Hispano cannons, a 3,500-pound thrust de Havilland Goblin. Now this engine is not like a standard jet engine that you see on normal aircraft. This is actually a centrifugal flow jet engine. Whereas the jet fighters that were developed by the...
...set up the Vampire Preservation Group in 2005.
Incredible to think that the Vampire was the first jet to cross the Atlantic Ocean. Now that would have been scary.
Yes, and I think the first...
Canada and also the Pacific use bottle bombs. They get razor blades, put them inside empty beer bottles and throw them out. They made an incredible screaming noise. You can see this is an amphibian aircraft. Gear is down. On a lot of the aircraft that were operated in the Pacific, when they were ordered as amphibians, it was found that they needed greater range. So what they did is they just pulled the undercarriage out, a huge well on either side of the fuselage. They covered it over and turned it into massive fuel tanks. Used to rescue downed pilots on what were known as Dumbo missions, where the US Navy guys and US Marine Corps would be attacking island positions in the Pacific. The Catalinas were sent out to loiter near the islands in case there was an aircraft that was downed. And they would then go in and try to rescue them, often under heavy fire. It was actually US Navy Catalina that rescued 56 survivors from the USS Indianapolis that had been sunk after delivering the first A-bomb. In the war in the Pacific, it was actually an RAF Catalina of number 205 Squadron. It was based in Singapore and it was actually shot down by Japanese fighters in the Gulf of Thailand 19 hours before the attack on Pearl Harbor. The entire crew perished in that attack. And you can see that this aircraft was just a wonderful machine. That many people considered it obsolescent before the outbreak of the world of World War II. They're also built under license by the Russians. So every theater of the war, you would find a Catalina.
Unfortunately, the bombers often were not undefended, and so this proved to be a very useless, now dated tactic, and was fairly quickly dropped in favor of the leader and wingman, as was used by the Germans. Jeff Milson, the leader, used to fly Phantoms for the Royal Air Force, and more recently he was flying Airbus aircraft for British Airways. Now recently retired. Richard Menage is wingman. Not just the Red Arrow Jumper Secret Band. It's Paul Revel, former Blackburn Buccaneer pilot. They used to refer to those as black bananas in their day. Now retired airline captain. And Dicky Amaboto, former RAF Tornado pilot. And here they come. This is worth a photo. Coming from right to left in Big Vic formation. I beg your pardon, this is box formation. This is actually their chipped ribbon. They don't call this chipped diamond. It is where you normally call it a diamond formation, but with one bit missing. That's because we were manned down today. The predecessor team to the Tiger 9 was the Diamond 9, which operated throughout the late 80s and 90s and were very popular, and they had the Diamond formation as their signature manoeuvre. So in tribute, so as not to sort of steal their thunder, we've always called ours box, bacon and an arrow. Again, very tight formation, worth a photo, they're doing jolly well. Formation. Well done, guys. And you'll notice the different colours on these. Now, originally these were military trainers, so they'd have been entirely in camouflage with yellow on the underside. Indeed, one of the aircraft, that being flown by Richard Menage, is exactly in those colours. However, once the war has ended and no longer needed for thank you. And the team is the display team of the de Havilland Moth Club, the club that encourages the maintenance. Followed by closely by David's sister, the former Lightning pilot, a man who runs an oyster farm up in Scotland, currently living North Yorkshire. Unassisted to Australia, not in this aircraft, but in another, back in 1978 in Phantoms, then a British Airways captain, distinctive green aircraft. He has his wife and two daughters, and say in the crowd, obviously his son, his Tom is flying in the display itself. Slightly out of order. Next down is actually the aircraft I co-own, which is flown by Paul Revelle, former Blackburn Buccaneer pilot. Yellow body, it can only be the famous Fox Mike, the aircraft that has been featured in five films, including The King's Speech, being ably flown by Tom Wilson, training captain of Ryanair, and the son of the leader, Jet. Will arrange themselves into an order that will be safer, as we've made here. Nice space to make space to get themselves clear before the next round. It's Richard Menage. Oh, a little bounce there. And he's going around very sensibly. Any kind of bounce or trouble, get yourself out of it. Come down that door though. See how close he gets. He will clear, but we'll get close to those trees. They're the authentic camouflage that he would have been seeing in the Second World War. Now landing is the oldest type of bomb in the world. And it's Brooklyn's school of flying. They haven't been flying in the pub. They're only cable flying. Don't control. Silence is fine. Four cylinders, 6.1 litres, Howland, 50 major engines, 130 horsepower each, so collectively about the same horsepower as a Battle of Britain area Spitfire. Once Richard gives a good chance to see these aircraft up close and personal.
It's got a striking Union flag colour scheme on it. Registration Golf Oscar Kilo Alpha Yankee G-O-K. And Ian is actually Australian, but currently works as a flight information services officer at Cotswold Airport in Gloucestershire, the former RAF Kemble, which at one time was a base for the Red Arrows.
In 1944, was originally actually ordered as a Mark 8 that would have been fitted with a Merlin, built as a Mark 19. March 1945, it was delivered to number 16 Squadron in our trip operational wartime missions over the Hunt. Then in 1952, it went to what was called the temperature and humidity flight at RAF in Singapore and Malaya. At that time, the Indonesians were operating Musk.
Map changes to white. Red One brings a formation to the right. He's also a former Typhoon pilot on the front line, a qualified Hawk T2 flying instructor, and also a Takano flying instructor. He's also been the Takano display pilot. To the right of Tom Bourne is Flight Lieutenant Stu Roberts, Red 2. Stu's in his first year on the team, having flown Typhoon on 11 and 12 Squadron at RAF Coningsby. Now going to continue out Red 6. This is something that the team do practice, and we'll continue to display. The shapes will be slightly different, the display is ever slightly different, but we are determined to put on a good display for you this afternoon. We appreciate your support. The colours on, give them a round. Give them a shout. Red One brings the formation, calls them in six arrow, and simultaneously as they collapse that formation into that six arrow shape, now with six out. Bondi's been in his fifth year as the team, having previously served as synchro lead. He is a former Typhoon pilot, qualified flying instructor on a Takano, and was also as the aircraft rolls towards, you can see that iconic clamform shape of the Hawk aircraft. First entered service with the Royal Air Force in 1976 and became the aircraft of the Red Arrows in 1979. At the end of March this year, 100 Squadron and 76 Royal Naval Air Squadron closed, and the Royal Air Force Aerobatic Team became the sole operator of the Hawk T Mark 1. Red 5 is flight temp Dave Simmons, known as Simo. Simo has previously flown the Tornado DR4. The Harrier and the F5 while it was on exchange in the United States Marine Corps. You'll see that the aircraft had their air brakes out. This disturbs the airflow behind the aircraft. It's 70 years of sitting on the throne, therefore making her the longest living reigning monarch in history. In celebration of her Platinum Jubilee, get your cameras ready for the colourful Jubilee Present! Breaks away from smoke and red, smokes white and pulls up to approximately. Smokes blue as he performs a couple of barrel rolls in the double roll. Around reds, four or five smoking red, and then four or five smoking blue around two and three in rollback. One of the most trickiest maneuvers our new pilots have to encounter each year. Choreographed to ensure that we don't run out of smoke in each specific maneuver during the display.
So now they are coming into lands, they will come downwind, they will go across wind, and then they will land coming into wind. So they will land facing the way they jumped out. So let's start putting our hands together, please. Team coach, Flight Sergeant James Bruce is at the front of the pack. James was mentioned in the Queen's commendation list today. So let's give him an extra big round of applause, please. Flight Sergeant James Bruce, absolute legend. So they're doing their famous ducks landing, so they are going to land in a line. This is brand new this year as well. This is such skill required to be able to do this. So let's put our hands together for Sergeant Gaz Nicholson, Sergeant Ben Summit, Sergeant Bobby Mennery, Sergeant Dougie McCall, Sergeant Paddy Gilroy, Corporal Joe Finch, Sergeant Sean McCabe, Sergeant Owen Collins, and the Officer Command in the Royal Air Force Falcons, Flight Lieutenant Stu Philpott. Ladies and gents, your 2022 Royal Air Force Falcons Parachute Display Team.